Welcome to Soapbox Talks, friends. My dear friends, we have great speakers today. Two great speakers, Falguni Parekh and Dr. Mihir Parekh.
Hello, friends. Good evening, all. And I would like to introduce our next speaker, Falguni Parekh. She is a certified immigration specialist from UK, and she's a solicitor, certified solicitor from UK, practicing immigration since last 15 years. She has been assisting various corporates and entrepreneurs in establishing businesses overseas and getting citizenships also for them. She's a managing partner for Smart Immigration, Smart Move Immigration, helping various students in achieving their dreams of studying in foreign universities. And further, she has also been appearing on BBC talk show along with John Soppel, and has remained instrumental in the formation on immigration for the talk show, which was aired on BBC Radio 2. So, friends, without taking much of your time, I would like to invite Mrs. Falguni Parekh. Over to you, Falguni Parekh.
Thank you very much, Shefali. And thank you, Mr. Bharat Desai. We've been knowing Mr. Desai for very long now. And it's absolutely a pleasure to know how versatile he is and so many things that he had been into and successfully been into so far. So thank you so much. And I think Soapbox is a very wonderful platform where you are able to reach out to different topics, and you're able to help people with a lot of good information. Also, Dr. Mihir, it was absolutely a pleasure listening to you as well, sir. I have a little baby who's 5 years, and it got me a lot of insight on how I had to now deal with him. So thank you very much for all that information there.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Good evening, all the participants. I hope you're having a great evening, and I see a lot of comments. Everybody enjoyed Dr. Mihir's talk, and I was absolutely mesmerized. I think I learned quite a lot today about how to deal with kids. But I will take you now a little fast forward in time. So he was talking about really early ages of children. I will take you a little fast forward in time. We're talking about, say, when they are 10 and 12, because as he said, this is a long-term investment. We have to have a blueprint. We have to have, in a very long run, what is it that we want? What is it that we should plan for the kids? How would that look like? What is a trend in today's world? And I will try to share best of my experience about here. And I will first introduce our company to you, and my introduction, because my introduction is equal to my company introduction. So we are Smart Move Immigration. We are a professional immigration law firm, which is quite unheard of. It's very, very niche. You have seen criminal lawyers, civil lawyers, matrimonials, but immigration law firm, people wonder on what we are. But we specialize in only giving immigration advices. We established in 2009. We've since been there, and we are a team of solicitors and lawyers. We are about 20 people up over here. And we are recognized by Who's Who Legal. So in India, there are only top 5 immigration firms who can advise on the legal aspect, or who are legally qualified. And we are among the top 5 in India. And we have a very high success rate. We've been here for the last 15 years, and we enjoy an absolute success rate. We've got presence in absolutely the north and the south and the and of course the west. So we are in Mumbai, Delhi and Bangalore, and even if we are only in these 3 major cities, we still have assisted people from all across in country. And of course we enjoy a very good Facebook rating and Google rating, which you can see here. So what are we going to do here? What is the agenda for today? The thought was, when Bharat Bhai said that we need to communicate to parents about it, and we need to tell them about the prospects that the kids would have. This is the first thing I came to my mind, that I would love to talk about the feedback. You know, always though we do investor visas, though we represent companies in expansions, though we kind of help corporate clients, etc., and also individual clients to a very great extent. We've done thousands of consultations over these 15 years, and I wanted to share that feedback. That, you know, what are the thought process? Why are parents or why are business houses taking those decisions, or high net worth clients taking those decisions to migrate? And what are the elements that they're thinking while they're trying to do this? So the key thing that we're thinking at the moment is obviously to enjoy a better quality of life. Most of the people that they come across, they say that we want a very good quality of life is why we want to go. Education for their children is always the center point. It's always the center point for everything that they are making this decision around. So whichever country that they're looking into, they would always be keen on asking on what's the education system like. You know, is it really favorable for the children? Is it better? And do they get to learn quite a lot? Of course, there's a work-life balance, and I would really love to share this bit over here. I had one of the very recent qualified chartered accountant working with PwC, and you think, you know, he's chartered accountant, he's already started working, but he doesn't have time. Even if he was newly qualified, PwC is quite demanding. He was to work late hours, on weekends he's busy, and he has to go out for auditing. And then he decided to move to Scotland. And now he's got so much time, he's chatting more with his mother than he could ever do when he was in India. And the mother said, I think I have got enough of you now. So I think there's quite a lot of work-life balance, and you get a lot of time to spend. And there's benefit of tax regimes. These are the corporate aspects which one looks into. And it, of course, opens up boundaries for businesses to expand, to grow. It gives you a plan B, it gives you a dual citizenship, it gives you one more. So by birth, of course, we're all Indian and we have Indian passport, and nobody can take that away from us. But if you're looking for a plan B in the given global scenario, then this is an opportunity to have that plan B by getting citizenship and enjoying visa-free travel. It's also different weather conditions. I mean, I know a few people from UK don't like UK weather and go to Australia, but few people from India enjoy the cold weather in the UK, and they love to go to the UK. So I think it's preferential here, where people have preferences on what they enjoy. So it's a different weather condition, and it's also the economic climate. Sometimes it's more favorable in few countries for your kind of a work, and that's why one thinks about to migrate. And if nothing, then it's just a good new start. It's just an opportunity to completely start something absolutely new. So with this, I will share again the experience, as I said, the feedback which our clients give in. So this is one of my clients' case here, and they have a huge, a very large retail outlets where they're dealing with, and they specialize in dealing with saris in India. And they approached us with a unique request to say that their children would want an admissions in the UK. And they wanted to be sure that all the brothers who are there in the family can send all their children in a better country to learn. And out of curiosity, that we asked them and to say, what do you think? Why do you want to take this step? Because obviously they're doing quite well here. Why are we thinking about this one? And I quote exactly on what he said. He said that we have lots of money and we are well to do here, but the environment that the kids are growing up is not favorable. You know, they were too cared about. They were too comfortable in the environment that they were. And we want them to be polished so that when they speak, when they interact, and when with the others, their standard of presentation is better. They are far more better than what they would have been otherwise whilst they are here, because here there's a lot of help available. So such kind of requests do come quite often. Even very recently, we have a client from Goa that I'm working on. And again, they are very, very established, but they're still thinking about moving to UK and giving a very, very different environment to the kids to learn. So with this, I will come to the trends. There have been some trends, and I can come up with some statistics that we have seen. So in 2019, HSBC had a survey done which said that 42% of parents were considering that the children should study abroad for their colleges. And these are the reason why HSBC survey says why parents are thinking is because of the language skills. Of course, there are languages, they tend to learn a lot of new foreign language. And what is a better way to learn the language is actually live in that country and interact with them. You become more native in the language that you're going to be speaking. It also boosts self-confidence in the children. In my coming up slide, I will elaborate a little bit more about this experience, which I have also seen in my cases where I have met a child before they have stepped out, and then I've met them back again after they have completed their courses or curriculums, and we had an opportunity to see them. It also gives them an edge in the job market because they have an education which is from a foreign country, and it does give them an upper edge. So preferably USA, Australia, UK and Canada are the most popular choices that parents have in mind when they're thinking about sending their kids away for study. And this is where they think that it is very good head start for them to get acquainted with their culture, with the language skills, and that would help them to excel and flourish in a lot of situations there. Also, traveling and studying abroad plays a very significant role in broadening the young person's horizons, not also in making sure that they are well equipped in their future as possible. I would also here like to quote, if you have been following up, and there has been a lot of videos around lately by the CEO of Google, where he has shared his experiences when he came from Hyderabad to USA and how he has built up from there to where he is now, and how he could become a CEO of Google by virtue of entering the USA. So it's a very good video. It's quite trendy. It's there up in a lot of social media sites, and it's quite helpful and gives an insight. So with this, we go to the next, which says on what is the impact of the international study on students. And we generally see that students become a bit more independent when they are sent out. They try to make their own decisions, whether they are right or wrong. At least it gives them the ability to make those decisions, which sometimes here as a parents we take those decisions for them, and then they don't get that opportunity to take those decisions and take the ownership and responsibilities of the decisions that they have made. This makes them a little bit more confident. It makes them more independent in terms of their in terms of their future life. And after initial period, they will depend less on other people to make those decisions. They will definitely know what is right for them and what is not right for them. And I think this is very, very important to help them to make that decision. Sometimes they may be wrong, but then there's a lot of learning from them, which will help them in a very long run. And I think here is a chance where they're miles away from you, they are in a different geographical locations, and they have to make those decisions by themselves. I think it does help them to do that. What it also helps them is to be open-minded. When children are uprooted from here and they go to a different country, they tend to get mingled with a different culture. So here we will have a set culture which they will have got acquainted with. But when they go out, they're having a global exposure. They are not only learning on the diversities that we see within India. Of course, India is a very diverse place. But when they are out, they will come to know how Turkish people celebrate their how does Chinese people think, or how does people from Poland behave. I think that kind of helps them quite a lot to be very open-minded in terms of different cultures, different countries, and different kind of people. And it gives them a very good perspective in terms of building up them in a very long run. Of course, it builds a lot of self-confidence in LNAP over there. So studying abroad can be challenging, but it builds a lot of self-confidence in terms of, you know, what they have to wear. Sometimes, you know, here they're quite worried how would I look like if I'm wearing something like this? How would people react to me if I'm doing that? But when they are out of that comfort zone, they are open to experimenting. They're open to say, let me try. And they might just do something that they may never have dared when they are here in India or when they are at home. You know, they would be very skeptical about, should I be doing this or not? I think I would share a very good experience. I had this young student who had kind of migrated for studies, and he was there in UK, and around that second half time in London, he lost his wallet, and he had a lot of his credit cards up over there. He had student IDs, some kind of a money, and then the whole thought that is there in the mind that, you know, I have to go to the police station, I have to make my own complaints, I have to call up the credit card agencies, and all of that. Those thought processes came up quite quickly, in which he then, when he was kind of discussing with us, said, would it have been possible? Because in India, I would just call up my parents and say, look, this has happened. And then they take it up from there on, you know, what they have to be doing, what are the next steps. And I think that hand-holding for a very long time does not help them to make those independent decisions or building that confidence or allow them. It also, like, a lot of comfort within home. I mean, we love and we care our kids, but you've seen, you know, after 21 years of being here at home, and when they're uprooted to a very new country, guys, it's not very easy for kids. You know, they've never been accustomed to washing their clothes, drying their clothes, you know, ironing their clothes, also studying, cooking. They're not accustomed. They're not accustomed to also then be with the peer group and the socials up over there. So I think taking them out of the comfort zone would be very important to build in this at a very early age, because in a very long run, this is what we expect them to be: very confident into what they're doing, to be very independent in their thought processes. And these small steps help them to go a very long way in their careers, in their personal lives as well. And it also makes them very thankful for little things. You know, at this moment when we are offering them everything, sometimes I think they take a lot of things for granted, they're not thankful. But once they step out, they tend to be more appreciative. I think I can very strongly relate to this one, and I've seen also a lot of parents coming back and telling me that they now value parents more than they were when they were here in India. They always thought we were nagging or we were trying to be overprotective, but now they appreciate everything that they have when they're back at home. And I think it helps them to understand that, you know, you can enjoy good things in life, and they don't have to be really expensive. They will find ways to have a budget holiday or ways and means to be thankful for little things, etc. So I think these are like the broad summary of things which we by and large see on how it impacts when students go out to study and the outcomes of there. On the other front, we see it's less competitive if they are, for instance, say, statistically applying for IIM. There are about 3,265 seats, but there are about 2.44 lakh applications. However, if you see Harvard, there's about 1,930 seats, but the competition is only 43,320. So I think then the competition also kind of comes down in a very long run. And the trend that I was saying at the moment. So earlier the trend was let my child complete the schooling, let them complete the undergrad support here, and then maybe we will think about post graduation for them to go in. I think that trend is changing now, and I think people are very open to even enroll children at a high school level. And that's a very different experience. In high school level, if you have, say, friends or relatives in USA, they would see that, they would be sharing this with you, that they have a homecoming, they have a prom, they have a very silly test, like, you know, you who can drink this fastest. The competitions are very different kind of a competitions that they have up over there. Something like who can drink milk faster than the other kind of thing. So that kind of an environment which you can provide them right at the schooling stage, for instance, in Italy, the learning models that they have, the student can actually pick up at the school level to say, would want to specialize in humanities or science or foreign languages. So they're not really compelled to study something that they are not interested into. And they can excel, therefore, into something that they are very good at. And of course, at a high school level, there's less of responsibility, which is different in college. So they are easy to adapt, as Dr. Mihir also said, the younger that they are getting into a different environment, the more adaptable that they get into. And I know one of my own associate who works with us has said that she was in France for some time before she came back to India in a very early days, as she's done few years of schooling in France, and she still recalls on how it was different, how they celebrated different functions up over there, how school used to perform up over there, and of course the language that they picked up. She speaks very good French at this moment because she's learned that at a very early age. So going abroad helps them to interact with the world. It gives them the opportunity to mature before most of their peers. And that, of course, gives them a very upper edge with their peers up over there. It also helps them to grow a network. Imagine you've been able to connect to people in Turkey, you're able to connect to people in, say, France, you're able to speak to people in Japan because, hey, we were buddies, we were studying in the same school and you've been up over there. So it's that kind of a network that you can provide to your kids, that they have a global reach, and down the line, even that plays a very, very important role and goes a very long way. So given that, what is it that studying abroad will change your child and yourself? So the minimum age to become an independent here is, we think, is 12 years. And the family who's considering moving, I think because they are 12 years, it's more ideal that the family moves together to a different place. And when you do that, generally under the immigration rules, your children are, because under 18, they're dependent on you. And because they're dependent on you, and they entered, they don't have to pay international student rates in the countries that they enter. Most of the countries would provide them the same facilities they would provide them to their own nationals. And the good part is, by the time the schooling is over, they become a national of that country. So whichever country you've opted out for, they become a national. And because they become a national, again, there are two ways of paying the fees. Is one is, because you're a foreign student, you tend to pay a higher fee for the same education. But if you are a student of that particular national, then you don't have to pay that kind of a high fee. And I think that's the thought process, that you save quite a lot, because those education are expensive education. And by the time if you achieve your citizenship and your child has progressed to the college or universities, then you don't have to pay the rates, which are very on the higher side. And how do you do that? So you can go in as a business visa, so you can go in and as investors. You can, if you are not looking to invest and you're not into businesses, but you're a skilled person, you're qualified, you have a work experience. So some countries have gap in their skills, migrations, and therefore they allow you based on your set skills. So you can therefore take your family on those visas, and your child, of course, can join you in up over there. So I think these are the most popular ways where you can enter in as a family and stay. This is where SmartHome can help you. So we strategize, we have a conversation with you to find out what is your thought process and how is it that you want to take forward. And then depending upon your scenario, whether you are into this or whether you're into a profession or you would want to go in an investor, we can strategize the whole thing that can help you to not only expand your business or help your family to get a better lifestyle and make the entire move as smooth and as seamless as possible. So this is about our presence all over in India. So we're large enough to deliver and small enough to care. So this is how we can assist and we can help. And should this be a thought process in your mind? So with this we end, and if you do have any queries about it, we'll be happy to kind of help you. If there is any kind of any information that you wish to know more, we're more happy to share that and give you any insights.
All right, thank you, Falguni ji. What you said, about the foreign education is very true. I have been myself, qualified in London. I studied there, and that increased my horizon of looking at things, the way people behave, and I looked at so many things, the cultural differences from India and London. And I traveled across the world to see, and that helped me to grow. My basic objective was to understand different cultures, religions, and the style. And yes, of course, making money. That was my objective.
Yes.
And I always thought of coming back to India, and that has helped me while picking up a job in India as well.
Yes.
So yes, of course, everybody I would suggest is to at least travel for experience, and also study if you have a chance and if you have the resources. Then yes, once you study, I would, as an Indian, true Indian, I would say that yes, you must come back to India and serve the country. Of course, there are many things we can discuss about it. But yes, it is wonderful talk by Falguni. Shefali and Tanika, I think, will finish the meeting. If there are any queries today, you can write it in the chat box or write to me or directly to Falguni Parekh.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I take this moment. There's actually a question for Falguni, ma'am.
And all right.
Someone's asking you about the Rotary Youth Exchange Program. So do you have any insights on that?
So yes, there are a lot of exchange programs. In fact, if you speak about UK particularly, within UK as well, there are a lot of schools and colleges, and now even in India, I think that's a new trend. A lot of colleges and schools are trying up to give this kind of an exposure and experience. So a lot of good international schools are encouraging and taking them. So you can apply under that. And you can also travel and study for under the exchange programs. There are also a lot of short programs as well. So nowadays, even kids are quite switched on. You know, if there are, I know a kid who was just in about 10 or 11 in India, standard wise, and she was very, very keen that I would want to go in fashion designing, and she would pick up courses and regularly come to me that I'm going to Italy because there's a 1 week course here. I'm going to France because there's about 2 days course or even 3 days course. And I think that is very important, and I completely agree with Bharat Bhai. I also, as I've studied in UK, but I come back to India, but it gives me an upper edge. I bring in all my experience and expertise, the good learnings, good practices that we've learned up over there, and I try to implement that in India, and I think my clients are quite happy. I have physiotherapists who have gone there to upgrade, and now they're working with Kokilaben. And Kokilaben was hospital was very happy to take them on board. So whilst you are waiting for the interview, there are a lot of people who qualified within India, and then the people qualified from outside, and they preferred because they want to give the best to the patients. And if you've learned something very new, which gives you an upper edge, then you are on a forefront to get even a good opportunity to share your experiences and build on your experiences in the field that you desire to.
Thank you for answering my question, ma'am. I don't see any further questions for our speakers today, so I think I would like to end on a good note, saying that there's a famous quote which says that you grow through what you go through. Whatever difficulties you go through, you are always growing through them. And I think that's an important lesson that we've taken today. So thank you so much for being a part of Soapbox Talks, taking out so much time from your busy schedules and giving us wonderful insights on such various topics. So thank you so much, and thank you to all the participants for being a part today. We've seen a tremendous, very enthusiastic participants today. Over to you, Bharat sir. I hope you want to end on something.
I am totally out of words to say to Dr. Mir Parekh and Falguni Parekh. It has been a wonderful session. We had almost 56 participants, yeah. And of course, some people would just take leave. But I think I hope everybody had enjoyed. And yes, if they have any queries, you can reach out to Dr. Mir Parekh. He runs his Urja School. And yes, you can contact me as well. I will share his number, both the numbers, Falguni and Mir Parekh's number. And if there is anything we can help you out, Soapbox Talks every Thursday 7 to 8, we have wonderful speakers. And I would also thank Shefali and Tanika Gandhi for hosting the program very well today. Thank you so much, both of you, sweet ladies. Thank you very much
Shefali for having us. Thank you, participants. Thank you, Soapbox team, for having us in this show.
Thank you.